Dylan, how are you doing today?
Doing great. Thanks for having me. I appreciate it.
I have to say, I have major respect to you. Not only for finishing really high to major with world leaders, but finishing exactly eighth. I was like, as soon as I saw that, I was like, I need to talk to this guy. He's a true disciple.
Right. Finishing eighth is basically like finishing first for a world leader.
Exactly. And you're such a nice guy. I'm sure you could have finished first. You just chose to finish eighth instead.
Course. Yeah, that's what it was.
What a legend. Dylan, could you tell me a bit about your 40K background, kind of when you started and any other armies you played besides World Eaters?
Sure. I'm a veteran of the Long War, as it were. I've been in this game since for about 20 years now, since the hazy days of third edition.
Oh, love it.
Yeah, playing consistently and competitively the whole time, really. So, which is sometimes a benefit, sometimes not, when you remember old editions. And but so I've been around for a long time. I've played a lot of armies. My friends and I kind of got into it together, and really Warhammer has been a great hobby to kind of keep our friend groups cemented
Oh,
together
yeah.
over the years and meet a lot of new people. So, we always enjoy that aspect of the hobby. As far as other armies that I play now, Raven Guard is my other army. I've been playing them
Very cool.
for God, probably like 10 years at this point. I only recently acquired my World Eater army about 2 years ago as a wedding gift from my best friend. He was my best man at my wedding, and his wedding present to me was the core of the army, the Berserkers, the Rhinos,
Oh, that's
Karn.
amazing.
He built, painted it for me, and since then I've been expanding it and matching the scheme and kind of making it my own. But yeah, that's amazing wedding present. I'm glad he was already married, so I don't have to do that myself, because that would be a lot.
Yeah, it's a hell of a wedding gift. But it's really cool, actually, because you mentioned playing since third edition. And I only started actually close to the start of eighth, so I'm one of the newer
Sure.
Chaos Space Marine players. Did you play during the 3.5 codex that everyone said was
Oh,
the highlight of chaos?
that was a good time to be a Chaos player. Back then, your squad leaders had a great deal more options than they do now. And in that old Chaos Codex, your average squad leader could be more dangerous than most people's HQ choices if you wanted to. It was
Oh yeah.
pretty fun. There was some janky stuff too, like Slaaneshi Siren Princes that had a psychic power that made it so the enemy could not target them with shooting or close combat unless you chose to fight them. So there was a lot of less fun things during that time too.
No, that's awesome. So you mentioned getting to World Leaders because you got the army as a gift. Have you played any other Chaos Space Marine Legions, or is it just World Eaters?
I have over the years, Death Guard was the first Chaos army I had. I basically played the same Death Guard army for all of fourth edition. So that was my main Chaos drive before this, and I've also played as the other a bunch of other legions before. I've played as Thousand Sons and Death Guard, like newer Death Guard since, and Traitor Guard, usually because my team and I, when we go to Adepticon, we often find ourselves playing as Chaos, so I get roped into playing as whatever legion we feel like
Yeah.
using.
No, that's really cool. It's actually funny you mentioned playing Traitor Guard. I was working on little Traitor Guard force. It was only up to like 600 points. I was really sad to see them go to Legends.
Yeah,
Such
hopefully
a cool idea.
hopefully it's not they won't stay Legends forever. Hopefully maybe we'll get another chance at a real Chaos Guard army in the future.
And they'll always be legends in our heart.
Right, of course. I mean, they were Legends the moment they came out, so
Exactly. Well, as one of the best world leader players out there, having finished eighth at the major, I'd like to talk to you about your list because I've been playing Chaos Space Marines competitively for a while now, and I have to say, like when I first saw your list, I say this with no disrespect, of course, I didn't like a lot of the choices. But that's one of the great things about playing Chaos is there's like so many different ways to approach things, and like so many different unit combos to explore. It's again, our stuff's expensive, but we've like such a deep kind of from the Chaos Super Faction, so many deep combinations and ways to build lists. Can you quickly run through your list for anyone that hasn't seen it yet?
Yeah, sure. So starting at the top, my warlord is a demon prince with wings and an axe and the Talisman of Burning Blood, which pairs well with his warlord trait, which is Violent Urgency for the plus one to advance and charge for everybody within six, including him. So he's very fast when he wants to be. And then I have Karn because he's a classic. He's a legend. You can't leave home without Karn. And then I have an Exalted Champion, who's honestly, I tell people all the time, he's the most important model in my army. He has the Berserker Glaive to give him just a little bit of resilience and a good enough weapon profile to kill Marines if he does need to fight. And then moving into troops, I had two units of Cultists, which normally I prefer using Chaos Marines, actually, but needs must, but I had to lose some points. And I have three units of eight Berserkers with Icons and a Power Fist, which I know is controversial among the World Leaders players nowadays. Everybody likes Lightning Claws, but I'm just old school with Power Fists, I guess. All three of those units have a Rhino. And then in Fast Attack, I just have two units of Raptors, two units of five. Elites, then, I have a Contemptor, Relic Contemptor with double Laz and a Rocket Launcher on top. And he is ridiculously expensive.
Yes.
I have the Mighty Leviathan Dreadnought. He has a Grav Bombard, the Chain Fist, three Hunter Killer missiles, and the Volkite in the chest. And that guy is like the favorite unit, my favorite unit in my army. He's just amazing.
Oh, yeah.
And then I think the last thing is just five Red Butchers with five Combi Meltas, four Lightning Claws, and a Chain Fist. And I don't think I'm missing anything from that.
Yeah, that's about what I remember. It's a really cool list because it's got a bit of 9th edition tech pieces like the Contemptors, which are really popular. But it's got, you know, the classics, the three squads of Berserkers, the eight mans with the Power Fists, and Rhinos. It's just got that classic kind of old school feel to it, which I think a lot of fans really enjoy. So first things first, what kind of secondaries did you take? Because one thing I was looking over the list, one reason I really don't like Red Butchers in World Leaders is because I think you occasionally need to force people to come to you. So I really like having a good to the last targets. Normally the big squads, they get expensive. But the way you have it set up, I think they're 180. So your to the lasts were the Demon Prince and the two Dreadnoughts.
Mm-hmm.
Did you ever find yourself taking that? And like, what other secondaries?
Honestly, I don't take to the last. I've tried it before, but the Leviathan, his whole purpose is to like force the enemy to kill him, basically.
Oh yeah.
So I don't really want to be taking to the last. And the Demon Prince, you know, he can be safe, but I've often found I don't really want to be shackled to trying to keep him alive to the end of the game. Normally by like turn three, I'm ready to start just making plays with him and kind of forcing the enemy to deal with him. And usually that ends up with him dying. I don't usually go for to the last. Honestly, my army is all about board control, and I'm very interested in spatial objectives like Stranglehold. I really enjoy that. Even on missions where it's not five objectives, I still often find myself going for Stranglehold over Engage. But, you know, sometimes Engage, Rod is pretty easy for my army, Banners, because I have tons of infantry. I often end up using mission secondaries, honestly, because, you know,
sure.
Without Codex secondaries, you usually have to scrape the bottom of the barrel sometimes. Then the killing-based secondaries are so matchup dependent, I honestly don't ever want to take those, unless it's just too good to pass up. And really, like, so the idea is, you know, my army is about board control, and I really want to be able to score points without having to interact with the enemy army at all. So, you know, I try to steer away from killing-based secondaries unless I'm, like, forced into taking Assassinate and hoping, you know, that something works out right. Oh, so, yeah, usually looking to just dominate the board and have presence that way.
Yeah. One thing I thought was really interesting about your list is I think because just one battalion, you only need three troop slots. So you could have just taken the Berserkers, but you go ahead and you take the two extra units of Cultists, not as attacks, but straight up just to get more bodies and more OPSEC on there, which, I mean, again, that's exactly what you're saying. If your goal is just playing the mission and controlling the board. I don't know. I feel like they get crapped on a lot. I really like cultists. I think for 50 points, they're fantastic. Well, they still have OPSEC. Now, in your list, speaking of board control, one of the main tools that many World Eater players use is the pre-game 9-inch move, the Khorne's Frenzy. Yep. I'm sure you know the name better than I do.
Apoplectic Frenzy, yeah.
Okay, I also didn't want to say that in case I mispronounced it. But anyway, Apoplectic Frenzy. Normally, people bring like a big jump pack unit, like a unit of 10 Raptors or like 8 to 10 Warp Talons. You entirely don't do that. Did you ever use that on the Terminators, or do you just not use that at all?
So I do use Apoplectic Frenzy frequently on my two little Raptor units, honestly. I know the big unit of Warp Talons for the turn one knockout or turn one to really go for a heavy hit is very popular among World Eaters players. And honestly, it's such a big investment to just have on a one-way ticket to midnight, you know?
Yeah.
So I do use Apoplectic Frenzy on one or both of my Raptor units almost every game. And basically I save them until my final drops. And what they are doing is just looking for opportunities to trade up. You know, like when I fought that Sister's Army, I sent one Raptor unit in to eat 5 Retributors and the other one like tied up a Rhino for a turn. Or, you know, against the Tyranid Army, they both were looking to charge into the Hive Guard immediately just to at least stop them from shooting for one turn to give me time to get across the board. So the Raptors, you know, they're a very low cost investment for me. So they kind of do that same turn one disruption thing that people do with the Warp Talons, just not to the same level of investment that, you know, the Warp Talons are. But, you know, even though the Raptors, they're obviously not as dangerous as Warp Talons, but because World Eater's stratagems are what they are, those 5 Raptors can still punch way above their weight when you are willing to spend some command points on them. So, you know, you can often surprise people that way. They don't really expect the Raptors to be able to do as much damage as they can. So, you know, I do employ Apoplectic Frenzy. My Red Butcher's Deep Strike, like 9 times out of 10. I don't really like that 15-inch move isn't really enough to get, or 14 in their case, to like get into a good position oftentimes.
Yeah, I completely agree.
Yeah, so it's usually the Raptors use it to get across the board and surprise people because, you know, a lot of the time, you know, I tell my opponent, you know, these guys are going to move 9 inches before the game starts. A lot of people just don't put together that they're also going to move 12 after that. So that 9-inch move is actually 21 inches and they're going to be right in your face.
So
the Raptors are the employers of Apoplectic Frenzy, and it's just to look for opportunities to trade up and screw with my opponent.
Yeah, no, that's really interesting. Again, Raptors on paper, they're just one attack, you know, not very impressive. But just for people
that are on the charge, 5 of them is 21 attacks.
Yeah, exactly. It's 21 attacks and World Eater's stratagems. Correct me if I'm missing any, but just for any people that aren't familiar, they have a strat for +1 AP. So again, you're basically AP2. They're like mini lightning claws. Vets for +1 to wound. What other kind of buffs do you find yourself using on them?
Those are the two main ones. The third one is 5+ Death of the False Emperor against Imperial targets, which I don't use on them super frequently, but I do use that on, you know, obviously other, like my Berserker squads use that a lot. But really that combination of +1 AP and +1 to wound is enough to put them over the edge to, you know, eat up enemy infiltrators or any kind of forward deploying stuff. They can really swing above their weight.
No, that makes complete sense. So just remind me, on these Raptor squads, do you pay for a weapon on the champ or is it just bare bones?
I don't think it would be wrong to give the champ like 1 or 2 lightning claws, for example. The only reason I don't is just to keep them as cheap as possible. If I had spare points to throw into them, I probably would do that. But, my list is such that it's just only the important stuff gets upgraded.
Yeah, no, that makes complete sense. I was just saying, I messed around in Battlescribe earlier. And I'm just saying, a 75 point squad, a lightning claw on the champ, give him a combi bolter, which is 3 points, and then buy a 5 point, like a flamer or something for someone else, gets them to exactly 88 points. So I'm just saying, something to think about for any kind of fluffy World Eaters players out there. There is a way to get 88 point squads.
Right, divine providence.
Exactly, and then they're never going to fail. They're just going to wipe out knights if they're exactly 88 points.
Exactly.
So you touched on the Red Butchers, which are, you know, very contentious. I think some people fall into a trap where if they're going to spend the 2 CP to upgrade them, they want to bring like a max squad and really get the most value they can. Whereas in your list, you just run a 5-man Terminator squad with the Imelda and the Lightning Claws. Just because the Lightning Claws, there was no reason not to. They're just so good.
Right.
And I thought about that a little bit, and it kind of makes complete sense because 5 Red Butchers are still killing like the majority of things they get into.
All right, give me 1 second. I gotta turn off the oven.
Well, for anyone just to kill a minute, on my painting table, I currently have a little Karn I'm working on. I got him primed and based with the Astro Granite. Oh, hey, Dylan, I was just showing everyone. On my painting table, I have a little Karn right now.
Nice.
Yeah.
Sorry.
No worries. Yeah, I also have, what else is on my painting table? I actually have, I didn't bring this for this interview. It was literally just here already. The Age of Sigmar, the Khorne Mortals from Sigmar. This guy is my World Leader's Masters of Execution.
There you go. That guy's a popular conversion piece.
Yeah. Have you seen the Sigmar line for Khorne? Those models are amazing.
Yeah, they're beautiful. I know that a lot of people use those models to convert berserkers because our kit is old and ridiculous.
Yeah.
But yeah, so Red Butchers you were talking about. Yeah, like you said, a lot of people try to go really kind of overboard on upgrading them and getting 10 guys and all that. I do, normally I run them as 8, so I do kind of go that route sometimes. But the 5-man unit is just, you get a lot of bang for your buck out of those 5 Terminators. I like them, and like I said, 9 times out of 10, I'm deep striking them, and they're usually looking to, you know, open up a new avenue of attack on the enemy army if I can get into an interesting position that way, or just kind of help support the momentum of my own push and just kind of land central and use their Meltas. Sure. And, you know, usually when I'm deep striking them, I'm just assuming they're going to fail their charge. So I don't usually like rely on them ever making a charge. If they ever do, they always set up with a charge, and if they make it, that's awesome, but usually I don't count on it.
Cool. So Dylan, just to clarify for anyone watching, when you say you don't count on them making a charge, or do you talk about you kind of like put them behind a wall somewhere where they're safe from shooting if they fail, or what do you
not mean? It's not always, you know, sometimes, yeah, like their job is just to kind of, you know, if they are dropping somewhere safe, it's to, you know, create presence in a part of the board where maybe I'm a little light. Sure. Otherwise, they're usually looking to drop in somewhat aggressively and kind of, and I've said this before with my other units, kind of force the enemy to do something about them.
Yeah.
So that's something my army kind of relies on a lot, is trying to take away decisions from my opponent or create multiple bad decisions for them. And it's by having these units, because so many World Eaters units are so destructive that you just simply can't let them touch you. So by setting up these units like the Red Butchers and other units in positions where there's many threats coming at you, you know, you can send resources into the Red Butchers, and you really should be doing that. But if you do that, then that's less resources that are coming into the Berserkers that are also attacking you. You know, yeah. So the Red Butchers are often looking to come in, shoot something with their Meltas, roll for the charge, see if they make it, and just have a presence and kind of convince the enemy that they're dangerous. No, and they are. And I mean, honestly, they are. If they live, you know, especially as Red Butchers, it only takes one or two of them to clean up a lot of units. So
yeah, no, that makes complete sense. I'm a little spoiled because I'm an Emperor's Children player, which means I don't right. have to think about what happens if I fail the charge. We literally make it 99% of the time with a reroll. I don't think I've ever failed one as far back as I can remember. There's definitely one downside to World Eaters is, funny enough, like for the melee army, they really don't have the charge buffs that even Night Lords have much better charge buffs than World Eaters. Right.
Yeah, it's really only Violent Urgency.
Yeah, I was actually about to say Violent Urgency on the Demon Prince. Do you make a big point to get them near the Demon Prince for the charge buff, or is it just like if it works out, it's nice?
Yeah, more often it's if it works out, it's nice. Usually if it's to the point where I really need those guys to make a charge, it's, you know, I'm not in a great position. So yeah, like they, you know, if the Demon Prince is usually busy doing his own thing, and if what he's doing coincides with what they're trying to do, that's nice, but I don't make it a top priority to always make sure they get plus one to their charge.
Sure. No, that makes complete sense. Just because, again, plus one is nice, but it's still far from guaranteed.
I was like, yeah, and I mean, even with I still fail it all the time, so it's...
Yeah, I think the math is like about 50% just a 9-inch with a reroll. It's up to 2/3 with plus one, but still, like, again, it's still far from guaranteed. And as competitive players, we do like to kind of, you know, assume the worst so we're not disappointed when the dice do what they're going to do. One thing I want to talk about next was kind of the meat and potatoes of the list. Berserkers and Rhinos, which has been a staple for just decades now.
20 years, yep. We've been doing this since third edition.
Yeah. So Berserkers near Karn and near the Exalted Champion. I mean, knights are dead. Like there's very little, like there's literally very little in the game that if eight Berserkers come in and you spend a CP for vets, a CP for plus one AP or whatever, or the exploding attacks, basically nothing is surviving. Now, in your list, I see people that run kind of the Rhino Rush, which I guess you're not a full Rhino Rush, but that concept. They That's almost the core. Always bring, yeah, exactly. They almost always bring the Dark Apostle for the prayer, for the Invuln bubble. I noticed you don't have that. Was that kind of a limitation of you just have three HQs and you like yours more? Or like the Rhinos spread out too much? Or can you talk about how you use the Rhinos?
Yeah. So, you know, the Dark Apostle, I can understand why people like it. But in, you know, the modern tournament age, terrain has finally caught up, you know, especially with the advent of player-placed terrain. You know, you don't really, I'm often finding myself able to hide stuff pretty comfortably where I don't really need the 5+ invul. Because, you know, oftentimes I can set up the terrain in such a way that my opponent will have to overextend if they're going to see more than one of those rhinos. And, you know, often that's usually not a choice, they're not a trade they're willing to make. And then, yeah, like you said, by not having that Dark Apostle, I don't really have an incentive to keep all the rhinos right together. They can spread out more and look for the hiding spots because, you know, not getting shot is a way better save than a 5+ invul.
Yeah, exactly. No, that makes complete sense. No, that's really cool. Sounds like you kind of split them up again, just because you're not tied to one spot. Plus right. The invul prayer, again, it goes off on a 2+, but I guarantee you, if you're going to have a key turn in the tournament, you're going to bring this guy, you're going to pay almost 100 points, and he's going to fail the prayer. And a 5+ invuln is great. But again, it's not like you get it off and then you're super confident, like, oh, okay, now I don't have to worry about terrain, I'll just put them forward. You still kind of have to assume you're going to fail most of those. And still, again, as exactly what you're saying, kind of use terrain. No, so that's very interesting. About the Berserker squads, the 8-mans, obviously it's an iconic choice. Was it kind of a playtest thing where you thought was spy was too, like, do you ever try like MSUs? Because when I was playing World Leaders, I loved the little 5-mans.
Right.
But I mean, the 8-man, in terms of like stat, in terms of like buffing efficiency, I mean, it's hard to match that. Kind of what are your thoughts there?
Right. Yeah. So the way I, you know, my teammates often push me to use 5-man Berserker squads, and I'm just not convinced by it. You know, what's becoming more popular lately is having one 8-man or larger squad in your army kind of as your hammer unit that you can send into the big threat, and then having 5-mans beyond that. And honestly, I haven't tried it. It would probably be fine, but I'm just very attached to having three of the hammer unit that can kill anything that stands in front of them. And my army kind of relies on that because, you know, like I said, it's all about board control and presence. And because I have so many alpha level threats, like with the Demon Prince and the Berserkers and the Red Butchers and the Leviathan that can kill almost anything that you put in front of them, my army doesn't have to back down from the enemy very frequently. It's usually I'm the scary one that, like, you don't want to come near me. So I really like the eight Berserkers because, you know, in the ideal world, when all eight of them jump out and get the charge with the buffs or with the rerolls or even without the rerolls, they can still kill almost anything in the game. And if they do have the full rerolls, they can kill just about anything short of Mortarion. And even Mortarion, they take a really big chunk out of him. So having three of those units running around is great. And having them at eight man gives me more of a cushion in case, you know, the Rhino dies or I get overwatched because I don't have resources to absorb it. So it gives me a few more guys to kind of eat the incidental casualties that are going to happen. Or if you charge a vehicle and it explodes and you lose a couple guys, you know, five man units get diminished so much faster. You know, because, you know, five Berserkers goes down to three when your ride dies, maybe, or you get overwatched and they just don't hit that hard. Or they don't hit hard enough to do what they really need to do. So eight guys ensures that I'm either going to have the ideal case where I can just annihilate anything, or I will at least still have five guys to kill most other stuff.
No, that makes complete sense. And now, actually, it's funny. I want to get, as soon as our call ends, I want to get off and actually experiment with eight-man Berserkers myself. just because I've never gotten to feel the full, like, force of, like, eight-man squad hitting something.
It's pretty insane. I fought a Grey Knight guy in Minneapolis, and he had the 3-plus invul Grandmaster Dread Knight, and I just plowed eight Berserkers with Karn and the Exalted Champ into him and killed him in one activation. He didn't take, like, 45 invulnerable saves.
Yeah, no, that makes complete sense. Just because of the weight of attacks, it's truly incredible. So let's see. The last thing I want to talk about was just the HQs. We talked a little bit about why you're not running the Dark Disciple or the Dark Apostle, which I completely agree with. And Karn's auto include. The Exalted Champ, the Wound Rerolls. I wish his aura was a little bit bigger. I wish it had the updated wording of reroll wounds instead of reroll fail wounds. But again, it's still fantastic. And the Berserker Glaive. That was actually a little tech piece. I loved the Exalted Champ with the Berserker Glaive when I was running World Leaders. I was kind of shocked no one was running it because it's such a great buff for him. It gives him a little bit of durability and a cheap way to get some multi-damage, which literally is the only multi-damage he can take that doesn't come with a minus one to hit.
Right.
So yeah, great relic there. The Demon Prince with the Talisman and the Violent Urgency, really big threat range. I love that. One Warlord trait I love on my World Leaders Demon Princes is, I believe it's called Disciple of Khorne, to give him full hit and the full updated wording for the rerolls. Versus, I think it's like characters or units with five or more wounds and a model or something against tough.
Basically any like heavy target where you're gonna need rerolls, you'll have rerolls.
Yeah, exactly. Can you talk about Violent Urgency versus more like an offensive trait for him?
Yeah, it's, you know, like you said, the offensive traits are really powerful, and they're not, you know, if we had access to more than one Warlord trait, I would definitely take something like that. I just, you know, like I said, Raven Guard is my other army, so I'm such a, like, a utility tool player at heart, so it's hard for me to get past having that aura of plus one to advance and charge, because it's such... Plus one to your charge rolls is such a meaningful buff, because even though that Demon Prince isn't landing to help out the Red Butchers frequently, he is usually helping out the Berserkers or the Leviathan or even himself. You know, plus one to charge just helps so much, because as a World Eater's army, like, you live and die by those charge rolls. If you fail a charge roll, like, that squad's just done and they didn't do anything. You know, so really, like, my army kind of relies on all of my charges will succeed, and that's why all of the important units have the icons.
So just for anyone that's not very familiar or hasn't run a lot of Khorne, the Icon of Wrath it's a 10-point upgrade that gives the unit fail charger rolls, which again, that's why I'm seeing the genius now with 8-man squads, because for a 5-man squad, it sucks to pay for that, because basically it's like almost 15% more points. But for an 8-man squad, suddenly that it makes a lot more sense to pay the 10-point upgrade to get the charger rolls. So we're really, really enjoying that synergy. Cool. So I guess the only unit we haven't talked about now would be the 2 dreadnoughts. And honestly, I love them. I've been saying for a long time that World Eaters, you have to bring a shooty core, because Karn's aura is he's literally one of the best auras in the game. Like, you're missing out if you're not bringing some shooty units. And I mean, Leviathan and Contemptor, great units. So I guess there's really no debate that, like, should you bring those? It's more about the exact loadouts you chose. Like, you talk about your Contemptor and Leviathan choices.
Yeah. So the Contemptor is partially because I just outright refuse to engage with Volkite. obviously, it would be great to have 2 or 3 Volkite Contemptors just hanging out with Karn the whole game. That would be way stronger for my list, but I'm just very stubborn about not engaging with Volkite.
Yeah.
So, honestly, you know,
I really don't think you're missing out. Actually, in my Emperor's Children, which are like literally the perfect Volkite army, because they have the relic for the full wound rerolls on a key turn. I'm honestly moving away from double Volkites, just because there's a lot of things that you're gonna, again, it's not bad, but it's just you're gonna regret not having some meteor weapons.
Right. The age of Volkite is definitely slowing down.
Exactly. Which, of course, being GW, right as everyone starts dropping them, they're gonna get a huge points nerf and completely stop being used.
Right.
I think the last games are interesting.
Yeah, the last cannons is just because, you know, that guy's job is to be my main heavy. If I need a vehicle or some kind of target like that dead this turn, that's his job too. And, you know, at the tournament, he did absolutely nothing for like 4 of my games. Sorry, my cat is throwing her tail over the camera. So that Contemptor, like, totally failed me for 4 out of the 6 games.
Really?
But in the 2 games where he did show up, he showed up, you know, he did what I needed him to do. So that was, and that's, you know, that's the way last cannons and stuff can work sometimes. But, you know, his, like I said, I go for the last cannons and for the rockets because he's like my one long range, I'm going to try to destroy this heavy target this turn kind of unit. Yeah. So, you know, sparing no expense and making sure that he's good at that. The Leviathan is, like I said, he's my favorite. He is just a boss. That guy is always awesome. And I know a lot of people stopped liking Leviathans because of the nerfs they took from 8th to 9th. But he also got so much cheaper. Like, that thing is 235 points, just awesome. And he, like I said, his job in my list is to be the tank and be the distraction Carnifex and just... He is going to be moving aggressively towards the enemy, and if you don't deal with him, he's just going to destroy shit. You know, and that's a big reason why I give him the melee weapon instead of opting for something like double storm cannons, double storm cannons would help me against Drukhari armies specifically, but I feel like the bombard works pretty well against a lot of other stuff, and the drill allows him to be this aggressive threat. That's moving up alongside the rhinos as another problem coming for you to deal with. And, you know, he is, fortunately, you know, he's like a psychological trick for a lot of enemies because they see him and he's big and scary and dangerous. And I talk a lot of shit about him to make him seem even more scarier and just to convince them to pour resources into trying to kill him. And then that's where his defense comes in, where he's, you know, he really is designed to be a tank. He's T7, 2 up save, 5 up invul. -1 damage, he can smoke screen, so you know, he's very good at just taking a hit, and oftentimes he will die on turn 2 or 3, but usually he has absorbed enough attention over the course of those turns to, you know, allow the rest of my army to do what it needs to do.
No, that makes complete sense, and that's something I've loved the Leviathan every time I've run it, because it's maybe literally the only thing in Chaos Space Marines that I can expose and expect to still be there next turn in most situations. Like, even the Terminators, like, again, if the enemy wants them dead, again, as Emperor's Children player, I run a lot of Terminators, and I've seen Terminators just fall like flies.
Yeah.
Rhinos, people want Rhinos dead. will make the Rhinos dead. The Contemptor is only 9 wounds, only has a 3-up save, no minus 1 to hit strat. But just having a Leviathan to kind of protect characters or just really require some resources, it's a great piece. And honestly, just from like a fan perspective, there are very few units that look cooler in World Eater's colors than a Leviathan. It's just so iconic with the drill and everything. So Dylan, I guess we've gone through the list and all your tech choices, and I love the way this list comes together. I want to talk about maybe some other options you could have considered, or kind of like where you're going to go next with your list.
Sure.
Because, you know, new armies roles coming out, new roles, things are always changing. I didn't see any warp talons on the list, which I keep going back and forth on warp talons, because on one hand, like, they're just so good. Like, the damage output is just fantastic. I've never been disappointed by warp talons. But, like, every time I take them out of the list and replace them and stuff, I'm like, wow, like, so much stuff is appearing in the list when it's dropped the warp talons.
Right.
Because these 1-wound 3-up save bodies, I mean, and don't even mention the invuln. I don't care. If someone wants warp talons dead, they just look at them.
Right.
I don't know. Have you?
Yeah,
honestly,
that's, like you said, that's why I'm kind of leery about warp talons, is because of the cost involved with them. You know, they are 40 more points than 5 raptors, and yeah, they do a lot more, but they kind of do the same job, you know? So, like, you know, my army kind of revolves around, you know, units have a purpose, and, you know, if I can do that purpose as cheap as possible, that's what I'm going to try to do.
What's your cat's name, by the way?
This is Radar.
Hey, Radar. Radar looks really sweet. Okay, so yeah, Warp Talons, I agree. I remember I was playing a game with, I was running a World Eaters and Death Guard soup, basic World Eaters with some Plague Burst Crawlers and a Spearhead. I know, how creative, I know. I definitely invented that. And I played a game against Thousand Suns. Remember, I like sent my Warp Talons forward and like killed a 5-man unit, barely killed a 5-man unit. It was a little disappointing. And then like he just got off like a D6 smite from Armon and then did the plus D3 mortal wounds thing, and a Warp Talon disappeared. And I was like, that was great, man. This is a good, fair, well-balanced game. So yeah, I agree. Warp Talons, it's just here's the part that gets me. I shouldn't do this because it's not a fair comparison. Every codex is different. But when I compare Warp Talons at 23 points to a Grey Knight's Interceptor at 24 points, it's really hard to justify them in the list. Now, there's other kind of classic units like Possessed. Can you talk a little bit about, do you ever consider Possessed in World Eaters?
Yeah, I mean, I would consider them. I haven't even used Possessed with World Eaters, to be honest. They'd probably be fine, but again, it comes back to like, what is their job in my army? It would probably be to ride around in a rhino and assault stuff. And, you know, they'd be somewhat better at that than berserkers, but, you know, they're more expensive. They don't have OPSEC.
Yeah.
They, you know, they do have more resilience in a meaningful enough way. But like I said, it just comes back to like, can I do enough of what they would do with the cheaper choice to then let me have more stuff doing others, you know?
Yeah, no, and that makes complete sense. When I was playing World Eaters, I found the Berserkers, like, their killing power is fantastic, but also the OPSEC on this unit, which you can double move in the fight phase. And there's a stratagem, I don't know if you use it often, but
yeah,
you can do the six inch consolidate. Which again, just for anyone that's watching, does apply to both activations.
Mm-hmm.
You get this OPSEC like, moving so far with like smart positioning and just like denying, just keeping their primary score so low.
So with that strat, sorry to interrupt, you can, you know, if a berserker unit mulches their target on the first activation, they can then move up to 15 inches with that 6-inch consolidate, because you get it on both of their activations. So yeah, they can really pull off some crazy movement shenanigans with that.
Yeah.
And then that ties into their OPSEC, like you were saying, to like land on an objective and turn it off and deny the enemy points.
Yeah, no, that makes complete sense. Have you ever looked at, because this list has the shooting core of the 2 dreadnoughts. Have you ever experimented with other, I guess, shooty units? Stuff like, Hellbrutes, I know, a Land Raider Achilles, which for anyone laughing at Land Raiders, there is one good version. It's the Forge World variant with the 8 multi-melta shots and an indirect cannon. Or any units like that? or is just you just love the Contemptor and Leviathan too much?
So yeah, I mean, part of it comes down to what I have, and I have a young daughter, so it's hard for me to do hobby time to totally change out a lot of different options. But you know, part of it comes down to what I have, and part of it though, you know, I used to use the Whirlwind Scorpius was a staple in my list before the ninth edition version where they lost the double shoot. And the big reason I stopped using it after that is because they just didn't kill their target consistently. They couldn't kill five guys reliably anymore, so that just, you know, wasn't worth it. You know, even though obliterators don't get the double shoot and all the other stuff, I mean, they're still like just a decent unit on paper. You know, that could be something. I don't do it, but you know, it might not be terrible. So no, I mean, for the most part, I've stuck with the dreadnoughts as my shooting core. And honestly, in the early iterations of my army, I just opted to not shoot very much and just have even more combat and board control threats running around.
Yeah, no, that makes complete sense. I've tried obliterators and a few different legions, and you're talking the wrong person. I might be the world's preeminent or strongest hater of obliterators, just because I feel like they're like 105 points per model, and you can get like two obliterators, or you can get a Contemptor, or even honestly, it's even close to a Leviathan, right? Two obliterators, and say what you want about Leviathan or Contemptor. They're not going to roll one damage, one AP for all their shots. You at least know what you're getting. And there's, again, some consistency with Karn giving them rerolls. And I feel like if your army's built around, like, okay, I have so few shooting units, you can't afford to bring in obliterators that are just, you don't know what you're going to get. Honestly, even the Iron Warriors, they have the strat to reroll things. I promise you, I've played them for a while. I feel like I'm the king of rerolling a one on a D3 into a one on a D3. I think they're just like one of the most overcosted units in the game. Like if they were like 70, 80 points, sure.
I mean, they definitely suffer from the old book inflation kind of syndrome. You know, they're not optimal by any means. I think they're interesting in that, you know, they can spike pretty high on their shooting damage, and it comes in a package that can punch stuff okay and is reasonably hard to kill. I don't know. Like I said, I don't really use them for, you know, the reasons, like you said, they're not consistent enough. And I would rather have, you know, the tough body of the Leviathan instead of their tough body.
Yeah, exactly. And then the minus one damage, the T7,
right,
makes a big difference. No, that makes complete sense. I guess there are other shooting things like Havocs and stuff. But I mean, man, gosh.
Havocs are just not, they need help.
they're down bad. I think they can be cool in legions where they can do the whole turn one drop pod thing.
Sure.
Some efficiency. But yeah, World Eater is just, I mean, again, if you have like five Havocs and a character behind them, they're both immediately dead next turn. Whereas a Dreadnought, if they want to get to the character behind them, that at least requires real resources, not like, oh, I shot some bolters at you. Unused low rolls and saves.
Right. Well, and the Dreadnought also is, you know, a smaller overall footprint, especially now that Havocs are on 40s. So, you know, the Dreadnought can manipulate line of sight a lot more easily than those five guys on 40-millimeter bases.
Yeah. Yeah. Plus it moves a little further. It moves like 8 or 9. Not to help
poke it does move 9. They're a lot faster.
Yeah. Plus they have like the arms sticking out. It's kind of easy to play angles with them. Compared to Havocs. So yeah, I definitely agree with you there. So I guess that's just about most of the roster, the units that make sense in them. I guess kind of going forward, because things are always changing, what would you say are kind of your best matchups in terms of like competitive armies that they face? And like, what are the biggest matchups you're worried about?
Honestly, as a World Eaters player, they're like every matchup can go wrong when you're playing World Eaters.
It's so true.
Yeah, they're a D-tier army, like solidly. Like anything can go wrong when you're playing World Eaters. But you know, like fighting against guard armies can work out pretty well if you get to go first and you get your momentum rolling. Like there comes a point where they just can't stop you anymore, really. Or you've like kept them hemmed in long enough where you just win on points in the end.
Well, I guess counterpoint would be, I hate playing against guard, not because like the army's like so busted, or like do I have anything against guard players. It's just that freaking vengeance for Cadia. Like there's always the chance that any given turn they could just randomly like nuke like something super high value from anywhere on the board. Because again, it's not on average dice, but it's also not out of the realm of possibility that a full payload Manticore with Vengeance Arcadia randomly kills a Contemptor. Like it's always a threat.
I mean, it's like I said, they're not an ideal matchup, but it's kind of a classic fight of the Rhino Rush versus the Shooting Army. So it's like, you know, if the Rhino Rush works, you can just like tidal wave your way through them. But you know, like I said, anything can go wrong in any fight. I mean, I think especially for my version of World Eaters where I have so many high damage ceiling threats, you know, my damage is just so far off the charts. The more elite the enemy army is, the better it is for me because I waste less of my damage potential then. And I really struggle against stuff like Drukhari or Sisters that just have so many units that I do, you know, I end up, it's harder, you know, I rely more on my own player skill to try to pull stuff off and I need the opponent to make mistakes more. But fighting against stuff like Custodes or Knights, you know, as long as the terrain is pretty decent against a Knight player, my army can beat Knights pretty easily.
Yeah, no, and that makes complete sense. And yeah, actually that matches my experience exactly as a Chaos Space Marine player. And now as Emperor's Children, obviously every Legion plays it differently. Like Knights are, okay, saying a buy round would be way too confident, but a matchup I feel very, very good about. Because again, if the Knights just rush forward at you without like playing cagey, you literally could table them by turn three. It's not out of the realm of possibility.
Oh yeah.
In Custodes, you just have so many AP2 attacks. Because Berserkers is a plus one AP strat. That I mean, you'll just mulch through things. Like and again, they can turn off your rerolls. Okay, cool. You're still gonna hit them like 30 or so wounds at like AP2. Custodes want no part of that. They don't want to on the dice at like a good AP.
Custodes, like that fight can go wrong because you know you need those buffs against almost all of their targets. Like my Raptors don't really have a good job against Custodes armies because they're just not going to do enough damage to be worth spending the CP on them trying it. So you know, Custodes can go wrong, but it is like you said that. World Eaters are inherently throwing the kinds of attacks at Custodes that they don't want to be fighting, so it's not the worst match of them.
No, and 100% hear what you're saying about smaller armies kind of being an issue, just because, again, as Chaos Space Marines are very good about, like, powering up hammers, but again, if the question isn't, like, oh, like, can you kill one unit, but can you kill, like, five different units in different places, that becomes a bit of an issue, just kind of, like, more conceptually for Chaos Space Marines. So yeah, Sisters, again, a bad matchup. Can definitely see the bad Drukhari. Although, I mean, honestly, I'm thinking about it. I haven't played World Eaters versus Drukhari. Like, the kind of the new Drukhari archetype with the Telos and stuff. I mean, you're going to kill them. Like, again, like, those, like, big 20-man rack blobs. Like, Berserkers are salivating at the chance. Like, oh, there's, like, a bunch of bodies we have to kill. Like, Berserkers, like, the question is, like, can the Berserkers kill enough of this high volume unit? The answer is yes. I think that could be a better matchup than you expect. Again, comes down to
players,
but it sounds like player skill. You really know your fight phase tricks. I think you'd have a pretty good chance into average Drukhari player.
Yeah, and I haven't fought the new Drukhari yet, and I agree that the way they're trending towards relying on resilience and minus one damage and stuff like that is something that World Eaters would match up better against because we're all one damage anyways. We just drown you in and pull saves, you know. The Drukhari that I don't want to fight is what we had been seeing, you know, that has tons of rides and witches and witch characters that trade so well and stuff like that. But yeah, I agree that the new Drukhari direction might be a better matchup for World Eaters.
Yeah. No. It's funny. I was playing against one of my buddies, Alex, he runs kind of this, it feels weird to say, but like old school list with like a bunch of witches and stuff and raiders. And we were playing the other day and I had this turn where I like sent a bunch of stuff forward, like turn two or turn three. I told him, Alex, here's what's going to happen. I'm going to kill literally everything visible on the board. Every unit you have that's not in your deployment zone is dead this turn. And I followed through. Noise Marines, Terminators, Bulkhead Contemptors. I killed literally everything that was visible on the board. And then he was like, cool. And then, like, turn 4 and 5, you still have, like, infinite stuff coming out.
it gets hard with, as the Chaos Army, to try to keep up with a modern Xenos Codex like that, where their stuff is just, like, they're just giving it away. It's hard to keep up with that.
Well, I guess, actually, Necrons could be a good matchup for you.
Yeah, actually, when Necrons were super into the big invincible blocks of warriors, that was a great fight for the World Eaters. Like, I rocked up on a Necron player with his 3 20-man blobs and, you know, set up my charges. And he's like, do you think you're going to kill all those this turn? And, yep. And I did. I just wiped, like, 80% of his army in one turn. He just did not expect that.
No, and that makes complete sense. Kind of just more like a big picture level. Do you have a big issue with kind of fight less type abilities, or how often is that an issue for you? Just because as an older codex, that's one thing we really don't have.
Right. I mean, fight last is annoying. Death Guard fight last specifically is annoying, because that's probably the hardest for me to play around, because it's on a character who's in the middle of stuff, and it's such a big radius, and it, like, affects you as soon as you come into it, rather than being, like, you know, the Admech fight last on their squad leader. You know, if they misplace that squad and you hit one side of it where you're outside of 3 of the leader, you can still most the squad without having to fight last.
No problem.
So, you know, fight last is annoying, especially the Death Guard one, but it's not as bad as fight first. Army-wide fight first, like Emperor's Children have, or Slaanesh Demons especially, or even like the Cult of Strife or whatever. I think they do the fight first. That is really like the counter mechanic to World Eaters. That is the hardest thing to work around as a World Eaters player.
No, that makes complete sense.
Because, you know, like, oftentimes against enemies, you know, obviously everybody can interrupt once, and you do have to play around that as a World Eaters player, but, you know, sometimes you can set up a situation where you have so many fights going on that you just accept that you're going to lose one of them in order to kill 4 things this turn.
Yeah.
You know, or you when you're playing more conservatively, you know, you just go for one big push every turn, so they don't, you can play around the interrupt that way. But when it's army-wide fight first, you really become limited, and I can really only attack one thing at a time without, because our army is so, like, made out of a wet paper bag, it's like anything swinging back just kills berserkers or whatever we have. So it's really hard to work around that, always having to alternate.
And that makes complete sense. Plus, I find when you're playing a lot of, like, combat versus combat armies, like, there will be, like, a moment of relief, like, turn 4, when you're, like, looking, charge phase, and, like, look over their CP, and you're, like, thank God, they're down to 1 CP, they can't run. Versus an army like that always has fights first. You're, like, you're never out of the woods. Even turn 5, you can't even, like, charge 2 characters. They'll pick one up, unfortunately.
And honestly, there is, like, 2 Slaanesh Demon armies that are regulars at my local tournaments, and that's part of the reason why I take 8-man Berserker squads, because 8 Berserkers can kill a Keeper of Secrets, and 5 never will.
Yeah, no, and that makes complete sense. So I guess the question then is, well, actually, I'm trying to think, Chaos Space Marines, what kind of fight last do we have? I think there's, like, one weird, one of those, the Scourged, I think one of those Renegade Legions has, like, a Whirler trait. But I remember that ties back to what we said at the start of, you wish you could buy more Whirler traits, is it's just, we're so limited, because, again, it's just so hard to actually write a list that brings, like, a scourged, or whatever you say, warlord, like, and then you're not, like, paying CP for the other attachment, or, like, actually get the other warlord traits you want. That's what I'm really hoping World Eaters, when, again, the rumors are they're gonna book next year, fingers crossed, I really hope they get those quality of life improvements, which I'm, again, very likely will, the additional warlord traits.
I think that kind of stuff you expect at this point, so.
Yeah, so again, it's one of those things, we'll just have to see exactly what they get. I guess that my final question would be, Dylan, with all these different legions, all their own play style, how would you kind of rank them right now competitively? Like, basically, where are World Eaters in the Chaos Space Marine meta? And then, like, which legion do you think, like, if you had to go, like, tomorrow and win LVO or something with Chaos Space Marines, Okay, that's not happy. Like some smaller tournaments.
No, I mean I would try it. I would try it with World Eaters, of course. But
yeah, again, of all the World Eaters players out there, you have a great chance, a good chance as anyone. But again, which Legion do you think is the best? I guess actually, time. Let me throw an additional part of the question at you, Dylan.
Sure.
Kind of Chaos overall. How do you rank World Eaters and Chaos Space Marines relative to Death Guard, Thousand Suns, and Demons?
Yeah, I think Death Guard and Thousand Suns are definitely just head and shoulders above regular Chaos Space Marines at this point. They are modern books with all the things that come with that. And they have, the army abilities, all that, so I think they're definitely up there. Chaos Demons, if you're not engaging with Slaanesh, there's two versions of Chaos Demons. It's, are you playing Slaanesh and that Lord of Change that's really good? Or are you doing the other chaos, Khorne Demons that are just why are you even trying? It's Khorne Demons are just the worst.
Yeah.
Chaos Demons are kind of split. There's a very good part of Chaos Demons and there's a lot of bad things about Chaos Demons. Bellicor is another good part of Chaos Demons now. Bellicor's cool because he's allowing other units to shine from the Chaos, Demons book, which is fun. So it's not all just four keepers. Keepers and Lord of Change or whatever. So yeah, I think, Chaos Space Marines, the best Legion, if I had to try to win LVO, my playstyle, I'd probably be looking at something like Emperor's Children, because I like that you have that reliable deep strike ability, your units participate well in the shooting phase and just inherently participate better than average in the fight phase because of the fight first.
Yep.
So and you still have access to psychic powers, which is pretty great. I think Emperor's Children are just really well-rounded and really can pump out some just devastation with those Noise Marine squads. It's kind of insane what they can do.
Yeah.
Beyond that, Iron Warriors are another strong contender. We've seen things like the Triple Lord of Skulls. Iron Warriors is neat. It's not something that I would do because I don't like super heavies. I think having a single Lord of War is it'll raise the floor of your performance, but it'll also kind of cap your ceiling of how well you're going to do against. Because once you start running into opponents that can just easily handle a Lord of War, you just don't get to win those games anymore.
Yeah.
Other legions, World Eaters, I know they're considered one of the worst Chaos Legions because we don't have warp time and stuff like that. But World Eaters are really good at playing the game the way 9th edition wants you to be playing, of being proactive and getting out there and vying for board control. Yeah. So, I think that they are better than their reputation suggests. I don't think they're the best by any means, but they're also not the worst, I think Word Bearers are pretty low on the totem pole these days. I don't even know enough about Word Bearers do, and that's kind of an answer.
Oh, come on. Dylan. You're breaking my heart over here. I'm a huge Word Bearers fan. And
I still blame Word Bearers for the heresy, so I don't care about kicking them when they're down.
So that's fair. My promise to you is I'll send you a World Eaters list, or excuse me, a Word Bearers list in the next few days. And hopefully at least you're going to be like, okay, I can see that winning some games because I've been playing.
Yeah.
I don't know the tricks.
They have some cool stuff they can do. I just, like I said, I don't know enough about what they can do. And I feel like that's part of an answer of how good they are.
That's fair.
If you don't know what they do, they're probably not that amazing.
That's fair. Yeah.
But, Night Lords are another one that's down there. They have some interesting tricks, but their whole core mechanic is leadership manipulation. And GW just has never gotten that down very well, I don't think.
No, so I see what you're saying. I will say the one good thing I like about, okay, not the one good thing, but my favorite part of Night Lords is they have the strat to prevent fallback.
Right.
Imagine if World Leaders had that. You get the double move, you can tag a bunch of different things that prevent fallback. That would be pretty incredible, which I guess is why World Leaders don't have it. It might be a little too good.
Right. Well, I mean, Lords can still take Berserkers, and they can still do their double activation stuff. It's just, World Eaters use Berserkers, are the ones that use Berserkers because of our strats that make Berserkers so much more dangerous than they would be.
No, that makes complete sense. Have you messed around with Alpha Legion at all? Because I know
I'm very much a purist. Like, even in 8th edition, when you were encouraged to soup armies, I never did. I'm just very stubborn and old school that way. I refuse to. So I don't engage with Alpha Legion. One of my good friends played some Alpha Legion and crazy chaos soups throughout 8th edition. And, you know, I really respect what they can do. You know, turning on board-wide 12-inch deep strike denial for a turn is pretty interesting. And they're hitting all that other stuff. Like, you know, so, you know, a lot of the Chaos Legions, I think, you know, they're not top tier competitive armies by any means, but they have some really interesting suites of tricks that can allow good players to flex their skill, which is honestly, for me as a player, that's like all I'm ever looking for in an army is like, I don't want to be playing, you know, Grey Knights that are
100%
top of the meta and you're when every game you walk up to, you're expected to win. It's more fun to win when you're not supposed to.
Yeah. 100%. Actually, one of my favorite things to do is, I probably shouldn't say this on camera, but you know what? It's my own website. I can do what I want. One thing I really like to do is come to the table. And I don't do this like intentionally to like mislead anyone, because I don't do gotcha stuff. Like, I'll tell people all the main stratagems to note.
Right, of course, yeah.
I don't believe in this stuff at all. And I think, like, again, every good player I know actually plays that way. It's really, also it's like very bush league to do gotcha stuff. But I do like to kind of like moan about the matchup at the start, although I'd be like, oh, friggin' Grey Knights. Oh, hey, I'll make a joke like, hey, by the way, do you know your witches have as many wounds as my Noise Marines?
Right.
And just to kind of get them a little like, start underestimating what the list can do. Because again, Chaos Space Marines, they have a ton of weaknesses. But if you underestimate them, you're like, you get sloppy and like, you like don't measure a threat range properly and let like a Chaos Space Marine unit get in. God, and the damage is just fantastic.
Well, yeah, like you said, you know, Chaos Space Marines. Yeah, Chaos Space Marines really revolve around hyping up those hammer blows, and they really can push some extreme damage outputs. So, yeah, if your opponent does not understand the real threat they're facing, or they don't put it together of the combo of the things you can do, yeah, you can really. And I mean, I do that with Berserkers all the time. People just do not fully comprehend how many attacks I'm going to have.
Yeah, exactly. So they understand, like, Berserker, it's fine, like, it'll be damaging. But like a unit of like 4 Berserkers are like, okay, it's just like a half strength unit, and then like it'll like wipe out like a unit of like Blade Guard, and they'll be like, wait, what just happened? The unit was like half dead already, kind of ignored it at that point. And just about the whole gotcha thing, I think like Chaos Space Marines, like I think they're probably like Alpha Legion, I think, is a great example. Like, if someone's an unethical player and like likes gotcha type stuff, I think Alpha Legion would be really good, like if you like refuse to tell anyone. Unfortunately, like I would never play that way. I would tell someone everything at the start. And that kind of comes down to the army, just like, we don't have like the deep toolbox to kind of have like counters to counters that everyone else has.
Right.
But again,
well, I found, you know, with Chaos armies, it's like, we don't, like you said, we don't have a lot of modern tricks. Like, there's no way, like, I have no way in my army of advancing and charging except for the Demon Prince.
Yeah.
You know, my Berserkers are just guys and rhinos. They're going to jump out 9 inches and try to assault you. And that's literally all I can do. But they do, I lost my train of thought, of course.
The Butcher's Nails Biting Deep.
Yeah, that's what it is, really.
Yeah.
I don't know where I was going with that. Anyways, we don't have a lot of the modern conveniences, but we do have, you know, some tricks up our sleeves, and like you said, we have I should say Veterans of the Long War is like the thing that Chaos Marines have, and I have been a staunch supporter of that, like all through 8th edition and 9th edition. I will always tell people that's the best stratagem in the game. Like, you're gonna use it every turn, you're probably gonna use it twice a turn in some armies, and it gives one of the most significant buffs in the game. +1 to wound is huge every time you use it. So like, I love that strat, and I know people are upset that Death Guard and Thousand Sons have to pay 2 CP for it now, but honestly, it's still worth it. Like, I'm still gonna do it with my Berserkers when it matters, you know.
It's fantastic. And again, people will be like, oh well, you're never gonna lose that. We're gonna gain so many other things when Vets goes to 2 CP that, I mean, you can't really stress about that. And it's probably the best CP you can spend in the game right now. Just so good. And again, as long as we have that, even a small unit will always hit much harder than people expect.
Right.
Yeah. Again, it's one of those things where, again, we're playing at a very interesting time. What I love about Chaos Space Marines right now, and Demons also my love, but just in the context of Chaos Space Marines, is I feel like every high level Chaos Space Marine player I talk to, it's like it's a pretty small group of people playing them and doing pretty well. I'll talk to like a Chaos Space Marine player that like does well with them. I'll be like, why do you pick the army? They'll be like, oh, like I love the aesthetic, or like I've been playing them for decades or whatever. I'll talk to like one of my local guys around the Grey Knights, why are you playing Grey Knights? He's like, oh, they have a good matchup into XYZ. You talk to a Chaos Space Marine guy, they're like, oh, well, have you read the Black Legion series? And I mean, how could I not read these guys? It's a weird point, it's really like just the hardcore fans. But there's still a lot of great players, Dylan, like yourself, a lot of other people, still getting some wins. So I guess my final message would just be to any Chaos Space Marine players or anyone playing kind of a lower tier faction is just, again, your book still has some powerful tricks and you're missing out on some things by not having that edition codex. We also have some things like, again, 1CP vets that probably we shouldn't have. Again, look at your codex, you know, try to build a list that plays the mission well. Like, I love your list. It has so many little tools for playing the mission well. And just don't get discouraged, you know. It's just a game. Still have fun. And you can still do well if you play well and know your army very well, which, again, you're a true veteran of the Long War, Dylan.
And I, you know, offering that perspective, you know, I will say, you know, to newer players, you know, ninth edition is, you know, having played pretty much every edition of Modern 40K, ninth edition is really a golden age of 40K. Like, it's so much better than it has been in a long time. You know, especially now that modern, you know, events are starting to modernize their terrain. I think, you know, player placed terrain has been such a good thing for the game. Player placed terrain allows armies like mine to, you know, swing above their weight and gives good players a chance to flex their skill and actually participate in the game against the modern armies that, you know, on paper should just crush them. So, you know, new players trying to get into Chaos Marines, you're definitely picking a hard road, but, you know, it can be really rewarding.
No, that makes complete sense. I think that's why one of the things about the edition, I love that you called it a golden age, just because I think a lot of people have so many complaints about like, oh, balance. I think people complain about balance. And again, I didn't play, but I've heard from people that did play. There's a lot of rose tinted glasses about balance in mind compared to balance in previous editions. Again, and just everything like player placed terrain or picking secondaries is another chance where a good player can kind of think ahead and make a decision that lets them catch up against a better codex. All these decisions, again, it's ways for players to, you know, the more decisions you make, the more chances good players have to gain an edge, even if their book is not a truly great codex. I love that perspective. So Dylan, I guess, when are we going to see you next? Like, what, do you have any big turns coming up?
So like I said, I have a young daughter, so my tournament traveling is a little hampered lately. I can't be flying around to every super major every month, but there's a local GT coming up in the end of January, like the week before LVO, that I'll be playing in, which should be a great time, a classic Wisconsin beer hammer style event, but awesome. Still five rounds with a lot of very strong competitive players. Sure. So it'll be a good time.
Awesome, Dylan. Well, hey, best of luck. I want to say thanks so much for coming on. It's always great to hear from someone taking an army that's not at the top of the meta and still, you know, getting some wins, still playing them well. And dude, you really know your stuff when it comes to Chaos Space Marines. So Dylan, thanks so much for coming on. A true pleasure chatting with you.
Yeah, thanks for having me. It's been a lot of fun. I always love spreading the good word of Chaos Marines and World Eaters. So.